Hiya folks, welcome back. A question that comes up a lot on this channel is what sort of fixings should I use for putting whatever onto a wall? And unfortunately, it's a very difficult question for me to answer without potentially getting sued, because without actually seeing what you're putting on the wall and without seeing the wall and without physically being in the room, it's not something I can easily advise on. But what I figured would be a much more useful thing to show you is how to work it out for yourself. And the way that I've worked it out over the years is using the load tables and data tables that are publicly available on the internet. And through that sort of information, I've kind of narrowed it down to a bunch of fixings that I use for pretty much everything, from very lightweight stuff all the way up to really heavy duty stuff. And that covers me for pretty much every scenario. I'm not saying these are the fixings that you should use. I'm just saying, for me, these are the ones that I've ended up using over time, mainly because I know the loading tables almost off by heart for these. The tricky thing in all of this is getting hold of the load tables in the first place, and that's why I tend to use Fischer fixings. This isn't sponsored by Fischer or anything like that, but I use Fischer fixings just because it's easy to get hold of the data tables. If you want to use a different manufacturer, absolutely fine. Just bear in mind some of the things that I'm going to tell you in this video. Just make sure that we're comparing apples with apples, because often the marketing materials that you'll read don't give you proper real-world figures. And it's really important that you take into account things like safety factors, whether it's an axial load or a shear load, and all sorts of other things, which I'll show you in a minute. A lot of people just guess with this sort of stuff, and they'll think, oh, well, if I'm putting something heavy, like really heavy up, I'll use wall bolts. If I'm putting something light up, I'll use like GP fixings and stuff. But if you're charging a customer to put something on the wall and it falls down and it injures someone, then you are personally liable. So it's really important that you have at least done your homework to say, well, you know, I did check the loading tables and it should have been fine. And it turns out that the customer was hanging off the shelf and that's what caused it to fall off the wall. So if you know you've checked the loading tables, it should at least give you a bit of extra peace of mind. And it means that if something does go wrong, then it's probably not going to be your fault. So I'll show you on the Fischer website how I get hold of all this information, and hopefully from that you can work it out from other manufacturers how you need to go through this process, and you can work out for yourself what sort of loadings the fixings can handle, and then you'll know exactly what to use to put your thing on the wall. So I'm on the Fischer fixings website here, and all I'm going to do is click on products, standard fixings, and we'll start off with plastic fixings. We'll have a look at the duo power first. And obviously you can filter and drill down and all that sort of thing. Drill down. As it happens, duo power is at the top here, so I'm just going to click on that. And then if I scroll down, we've got all the different variants here. So I'm going to go for the 6mm, I think it's this one, 6x30. And then if I just scroll down here, we have got documents for downloading, and this is what we want. We want the load table. So click on the load table. What I generally do is I download all of these in advance and I keep them in a folder on my computer, or I just keep a screenshot of this on my phone, whatever, just so you can refer to it. You don't need to know everything on here, but you'll see. Let me show you. So first of all, I'm looking at the 6x30 plugs, so I'm looking at this column here, and then the next thing you're going to want to know is what size screw to use in the plug. And you can see here, wood screw diameter, it's suggesting 5mm. I mean, it doesn't have to be. If you're going off imperial sizes, it would be like 4.8-ish if you go for a 10 gauge screw, but as long as you're in that kind of ballpark, you should get figures similar to what they're showing in their load table here. So if possible, go for the screw size that they recommend, which is the 5mm. So if you've already watched my video about duo power plugs, you'll know that these can be used in a lot of different substrates. The ones that I'm going to look at here are going to be concrete, solid brick. We'll look at aerated concrete blocks as well, which is your kind of thermalite type blocks. We've got two to choose from here. We've got the G2 and the G4, but all I'm looking at here is the loadings. So I'm going to go for the one that has the lowest loading just to be on the safe side. So I'm going to base it on that one there. And then of course, plasterboard as well. So 12.5mm gypsum plasterboard is pretty standard. So I'm going to have a look at that one there. With that in mind, we are looking at these numbers here.
this number here, and this number here. Now, you'll generally find on these load tables that the loadings are always measured in kilonewtons. And kilonewtons is the standard that gets used for measuring force on data tables such as this. But it doesn't really make much sense if you're going to a customer and they're saying they want a shelf that can hold 30 kilos or something. So you need to understand how to convert from kilonewtons to kilograms of force. And there's various online calculators you can use for that if you just go to Google. And I'm just going to search for kilonewton to kilogram conversion. I'm going to go for this top one here. Adverts, try this one. Not much better. Try this one. Well, at least that's an advert for paint instead of Disney or whatever. Okay, so you can see 1 kilonewton is equal to 101.97 kilograms of force. So what have we got on this load table? Let's have a quick look. So for a 6x30 duo power in concrete, we've got 0.95. This is using a comma for the point because it's European, but it's 0.95 kilonewtons. So 0.95 is 96.87 kilograms of force. So you can use a converter like this if you want, but you don't need to be accurate to that level. The easy thing to do is just multiply it by 100, and that's going to get you in the ballpark. So if it says 0.95, multiply it by 100, it's going to be about 95 kilos that that fixing can handle. So 6 mil duo power in concrete, 95 kilo. 6 mil duo power in solid brick, 50 kilo. 6 mil duo power in thermalite, 10 kilo. And 6 mil duo power in plasterboard, 15 kilo. Easy as that. So it's important to have a look down the bottom left here because it often gives you a few notes to go with the measurements and you need to understand what they mean. First of all, it says required safety factors are considered. This is a really important one because often when you look at like advertising materials for fixings and it says, oh, this fixing can hold 200 kilos. And it's like, yeah, it's talking about shear load with no safety factors. And then when you take into account the safety factors and axial loads, actually it can only handle like 40 kilos or something like that. So safety factors are basically where you take whatever the maximum peak value that you get out of the testing. If you've ever watched my Test Tuesday videos, I'll be testing a fixing and I'll have my graph and it'll kind of go up like that and then suddenly it'll fail. Well, this peak value here is the figure that I tend to give on the Test Tuesday videos because I don't take into account a safety factor, but you've got to take into account a safety factor. And normally that'll be like a factor of 3, sometimes 4, 5. I've seen some as high as 7. If it's got a safety factor of 3, what it's saying is that it's giving you a figure a third of what it's actually capable of doing. So if it broke at this point here, and say that was 90 kilos, then with a safety factor of 3, they would take into account this figure here, which would be 30 kilos. So we're just like divided by 3. And the safety factor is really important because you can easily put more load on a fixing by hanging a coat on a coat rack or putting stuff on a shelf, or if a child decides to hang off something, you know. So you've got to take this safety factor into account. If you see a manufacturer giving really high load ratings for their fixings, do check that a safety factor is taken into account because often it's not. And if it's not, it's not a fair comparison. The other thing that's important here is that it says the load data are valid for tension, shear, and combined tension and shear loads. Sometimes it'll say tensile, shear, and oblique loads. But all we're basically really worried about here is tensile loads, the axial load on the fitting, because generally speaking, whatever the tensile load is, it'll handle a much, much higher shear load because of the way that fixings work. So if you see something that gives a tensile load rating of, say, 90 kilos, then it might be able to handle a shear load of 200 kilos or something like that. I wouldn't like to guess that. You can do your own testing, or you can check my Test Tuesday videos and whatnot. But the point is that you need to be looking at the figures that tell you the tensile or axial loads. And just as a very quick reminder as well, so when I say a tensile load, we're talking about axial loads. So tensile, axial. And a tensile load is where, if you imagine you're fixing, this is going to look a little bit rude. So this is your concrete wall, and you've got the plug going into it, and you've got the screw going into the plug. Well, a tensile or axial force is where it's being pulled directly out of the material like that. And a shear load is where it's being applied, the force is being applied perpendicular to the fixing. Generally speaking, the same fixing in the same substrate will handle much higher shear loads than axial loads. So axial loads, or your tensile loads, are your worst case scenario. So that's the figure you want to go by. And while I'm on here, remember, of course, the whole point of a plastic fixing in a wall like this is that when you put the screw into the fixing, it makes the fixing expand and it pushes up against the substrate, or it pushes outwards against the substrate, and it forces the fixing to stay in the material. And that's the way these work. So it's why it's really important that you use the right size screw. If you use a screw that's too small, then you'll not get as much force applied outwards from the fixing into the substrate, and it'll not hold as much weight. On the flip side, if you use a screw that's too big, what can end up happening is that rather than making the plug expand and grip onto the side of the concrete or whatever it's going into, what it'll end up doing is it'll just chew the fixing up and there'll be no fixing left. So using a screw that's too big isn't necessarily a good idea. Now, a thing that comes up in the comments a lot, to the degree that there's a t-shirt on my Teespring store that says, "Why didn't you test shear load?" And the reason that I always test axial load, as I say, is because axial is the worst case. But then people say, yeah, but whenever you hang something on the wall, all of the force is a shear force. And unfortunately, that's only really true if you're just hanging pictures and effectively two-dimensional objects of zero thickness onto the wall. That's where you're going to get 100% shear load. But as soon as the object has any thickness to it, then you're going to get an element of axial load. If you hammer a nail into a piece of wood, it's very hard to pull that nail back out just by pulling on it. But a claw hammer is a first-class lever and makes use of mechanical advantage, allowing you to pull the nail out using just one finger. Next time you put a shelf up, think about how a claw hammer works. So if you imagine a really simple shelf bracket, like the sort that you get on an IKEA LAC shelf, and that has, this is like massively zoomed in, and that has like a pole that sticks out in the middle, and then you've got your screws in the top and bottom of the bracket. Well, in exactly the same way as I showed you with the claw hammer, we've got an amplification of forces going on here from the leverage forces that we talked about before. Imagine this is like a claw hammer. You know, you can imagine literally there's like the head of your hammer. And what it's doing, it's putting a lot more force onto this top fixing. And we've got the leverage across the length of this kind of tubey bit that's, well, across the shelf, which goes over that. So we've got the shelf that goes over the top of the metal tube. And we're amplifying the forces predominantly on this top fixing here. So this is why it's generally better to always go by the axial load capabilities of the fixing rather than the shear load capabilities, because you're almost always going to have situations where the axial load is the one that you need to worry about. Another really common one is TV brackets. And TVs, you've got to be really careful with TVs, because these can put an enormous amount of force on the wall. If it's just a flat wall mounted one, so if we're looking kind of side on, generally it's like a flat bracket that goes like that, something like that, and then the fixings go through, and then the TV itself kind of hooks onto the top of the bracket there, and then you've got the TVs like kind of like that ish very bad drawing. But in that kind of situation where the TV is flat to the wall, yeah, it's predominantly going to be shear loads. It's a little bit of axial because, you know, that's going to be trying to tip forwards from the top. But yeah, okay, most of the loadings here are shear loads. But what happens if it's a TV on a cantilever bracket? Well, this is where things can start to get quite scary quite quickly, because if you've got the sort of bracket that can kind of concertina out, this is going to be a really bad drawing. Let me just assume, you know the sort I mean. They kind of, they can concertina out from the wall like this, and then you can have your TV on the end of this bracket. Well, what have I just drawn? I've just drawn another giant claw hammer. So think of your claw hammer as being kind of here. And we've now got a claw hammer with a TV attached to the end of it. So this is going to massively amplify the forces that are especially on this top fixing here. And that force will, in this kind of situation, that will largely be an axial force that's trying to pull out. It's trying to do this kind of, if you imagine the arc of how this would fall away from the wall if it was to fall down, this TV would kind of come down like that. I can't fit it on my drawing. If this was to fall down, it would kind of fall in an arc like that. So likewise, the arc of the axial load would be kind of like that, if that makes sense. So definitely in that situation, it's an axial load, and it's going to be a massively amplified axial load as well. So this is where you've got to be very careful putting things like TVs onto hollow walls, because the plasterboard simply, it doesn't matter what plasterboard fitting you're using, the plasterboard just can't handle it. And this is why generally if I'm putting a TV with a cantilever bracket onto a hollow wall, I will always make sure I'm going into the studs. I will never do that just relying on what the plasterboard itself can handle, because as I've explained many times before, generally speaking, the figure that you should have in the back of your mind for plasterboard is around 15 kilos before it starts to fail. It will handle more than that, but that's a figure that you're going to have to bear in mind. If this is a 20 kilo TV, you could easily have forces in excess of 100 kilos onto your fixings at this point, well in excess of what the plasterboard can handle. Let's have a look at another one. Let's just quickly look at standard fixings. We'll look at our classic red plug, but the red plug, it won't be radically different from this. The difference with the normal red plug is that it's not really designed for use in plasterboard. Now, some fixings you do struggle to find. So for example, the red plug I can't find, but it looks pretty much similar to that. I'm just going to go for the expansion plug S. Documents for downloading, load table, here we go. So again, I'm looking at the S6, which is the 6mm one. Again, it tells you to use a 5mm screw. The only things I'm interested in here, we've got concrete and solid brick. We've got aerated concrete as well. Okay, well, we'll have a look at that as well. Gypsum block, I don't use gypsum blocks. So 0.4 kilonewtons, so you're looking at 40 kilos. Solid brick, 28 kilos. And aerated concrete, 5 kilos. Once again, required safety factors are considered. Valid for tensile load, shear load, and oblique load under any angle. If you've seen the Test Tuesday videos, I had like nearly 300 kilos on a single red plug. I can't remember off the top of my head. It was a very high figure. So obviously whatever safety factor is being used here, it's quite a high number. It doesn't tell you what it is. It used to tell you what the safety factors are. I don't know why it doesn't anymore, but whatever. 40 kilos, I think, is playing it very safe in concrete. Let's see if we can find the little GP, the general purpose plasterboard fixings. For that, I'm going to go into products and I'm going to go into cavity fixings. Let's see what we can find. It's awful screw ones. Oh, here we go. For some reason, it's not showing a picture. Board fixing GPF, I think, is the one. And we don't have a data table. Why not? To all variants? Strange. Okay, no data table for that one. How about, maybe it's on this one instead. Let's have a look. Sometimes you have to do a bit of digging to find it. Technical data. No data set for that one, but you can have a look at the sort of figures that I got on my Test Tuesday tests if you want. And I only use these for very lightweight stuff in plasterboard, and I tend to use the 6mm variant. not the bigger version. This is the, what's this? This is the 8mm. I don't like the way it refers to this as HDF because there's nothing heavy duty about these. These are both general purpose fixings, and I've found actually that the smaller ones, the GPF ones, I've found they actually work better sometimes than the bigger ones for whatever reason. While we're in here, we'll have a look at my fixing of choice for plasterboard, which is expanding metal anchors, metal cavity fixings. Here we go. I'll just click on that. See if we can go straight to the data sheet, documents for downloading, load table. Here we go. And my go-to fixing for these is 5x52, which is this column here that we're looking at. It says that it comes with an M5 screw, but that's supplied with it. And generally speaking, we're always, almost always, looking at 12.5mm plasterboard. And you can see here, 20 kilos. And the interesting thing is, look, it's 20 kilos for everything. Because you're looking at the failure of anything past that, it's the plasterboard itself that tends to fail. I mean, yeah, if you go for double layer, you can maybe push it up to 30 kilos, but it's very rare with a safety factor. We've got a safety factor considered, and we're looking at tensile, shear, and oblique loads. The figure that sits in the back of my mind is always about 15, 20 kilos, around that kind of figure. How about classic spring toggles? Let's have a look at them. Gypsum plasterboard, this row here. I'm not even going to think about which fixing it is. I have no idea. But look at your numbers. 15, 15, 15, 15, 18, 7, 13, 15, 15, 18. As I was saying before, doesn't really make any difference what the fixing is. 20 kilos is your maximum that you need to have in the back of your mind that plasterboard can handle before the plasterboard itself just fails. Let's see, out of matter of interest, have they got any fixings that can handle more than 20 kilos in 12.5mm plasterboard? What about Duotech? I haven't shown you the Duotech, they're quite clever, but we'll have a look. I don't think it'll be anything beyond 15 or 20 kilos, but let's have a look. This is quite a complicated one, but don't panic. We've got gypsum plasterboard 12.5mm. Recommended loads in the respective base material for a span in the construction of 120mm. I'd need to do some digging to see what they're talking about there. Let's just have a look at gypsum plasterboard 12.5mm. This row here. And once again, look. 20 kilos for all of them. Doesn't matter what the fixing is. 20 kilos. For whatever reason, I'd need to read into what this is talking about here. Gypsum plasterboard 12.5mm. And we have got readings as high as 36 kilos. But I'd need to do a bit of research to see what they're talking about. I'm not 100%. If anyone knows, for a span in the construction B equals 120mm. No idea. I wouldn't chance it. 20 kilos. Is a figure that's generally at the back of my mind with plasterboard.
So there you go, folks. I hope you found that useful. Hopefully it's at least given you enough information that if you want to put something on the wall, you're not sure how much load a particular fixing can handle. Hopefully you'll know where to look now to find that information, and hopefully it'll all make sense. If you've got any questions about this actual video and how to read the load tables and stuff like that, then do pop it in the comments below. As I say, unfortunately, I can't give specific advice on what fixing to use for a particular object that you're attaching to the wall. It would just be too dangerous for me to provide that information without actually seeing the thing in person. But hopefully from this video, you've got enough understanding of how to read the data sheets that you can now work it out for yourself. Let us know in the comments below if you've had any horror stories with attaching things onto the walls. We've all been there. And that's how you learn, but hopefully you haven't had anything too major go wrong. Also, let us know if you've got preferred fixings that you use on a regular basis. As I say, these are just the ones that I use all the time that I've kind of honed in on. I'm not necessarily saying these are the best or the worst or anything like that. It's just what I've ended up becoming comfortable with and what I use on a regular basis. But this isn't the only way of hanging things on walls by any stretch of the imagination. Before I forget, we are of course approaching Christmas time, and the Gosforth Handyman Christmas jumpers are back in stock on the Gosforth Handyman shop, so do head over there and pick up a jumper while they're still in stock. And I've been doing my little bit to kind of support local businesses and things. The Teespring store is still live. If you want to buy stuff off the Teespring store, you can. But I've been trying to source stuff locally and get hold of t-shirts and things that I will ship to you directly all around the world. We've got the No You Can't Borrow My Tools t-shirts in stock, and we've got the Drink Coffee Make Stuff t-shirts in stock as well. So you can find those on the Gosforth Handyman shop now. Plenty in stock to keep you covered over the Christmas period, including a whole new batch of tape measures are in stock as well. That's it for today. There is more exciting news coming up, hopefully within the next couple of weeks. So if you're not subscribed, please do hit subscribe. Take care, folks. I shall see you next time. Tidy bye.